Okay. Hold on. You go.
Okay. My name is Carl Littman, and good morning. And my talk today is on sum equals mc squared history before Einstein, and so on. But tomorrow I'll talk about something else. So in case some of you missed that talk, I've had passed around a stack of DVDs covering some of that talk tomorrow, and you're welcome to keep them. And in case your equipment can't play a DVD, you're welcome to take the USB flash drive instead with the same kind. Kinetic energy. That's a system where it's perfectly circular in velocity. This is a system where we have a simple harmonic motion. This is a system where we have something like a vortex, and here it's a closed vortex. But anyway, as I say, total system energy E equal to twice the easily visible kinetic energy. That is where the total energy is 1 mv squared, not 1/2 mv squared. That 1/2 mv squared only represents the kinetic energy portion of the total energy, which also includes a potential energy. So the slide there shows systems where the total energy is equal to double the kinetic energy, or in some cases, double the average kinetic energy, or that reality after a minor alteration. And so, barring unusual developments, if the velocity is c, the speed of light in those systems, then the total system energy is 1 mc squared, not 1/2 mc squared. Not all papers or talks teach listeners something so major and drastically new that few people, if any, have ever dreamt of it. So I think, unlike my talk tomorrow, this talk will not greatly surprise many people, but still some may learn a pinch from it. And I think that Dr. Chappelle, the MPA's founder, realized that not every paper or presentation would shock all members with Nobel Prize meriting discoveries, but rather that many would just gradually help members and presenters find a more holistic, circumspect, and satisfying view of natural philosophy, and better understand its historical evolution, and to help members gradually find more complete, reasonable, and satisfying theories. So that is my theory, my paper's modest aim here. We will start by examining over time what developments were really new and how new. Earlier than Einstein, Newton considered it extremely likely, and Laplace considered it quite likely, that light was an emission by an emitting body, and an emission of mass or corpuscle that traveled from the emitting body to the receiving body at the speed of light. And that therefore the emitter of light lost some of its gross mass, and the receiver of light gained mass. So naturally, I was vexed to learn that the photon delivered 1 mc squared worth of energy to the target, not just 1/2 mc squared. That is not just 1/2 mc squared amount of simple kinetic energy. And thus, surprised that the kinetic energy, when absorbed, seemed to cause the temperature to increase at the target consistent with a 1 mc squared amount of energy transferred, not just 1/2 mc squared worth. But mostly after college, I got to further contemplate the likely complexity of light, its behavior consistent with spin, or like something was spinning, and even in Maxwell's time, its polarization possibilities, and its likely wave-like motion, not purely straight line motion, and finally that even an ether was likely needed to keep the spinning photon or whatever from flying apart, from coming apart. And Compton's X-ray electron scattering work too, which assumed that conservation of energy and momentum held good. So I inferred from all that above that light was like a traveling system, even likely a conservative system. Then I ran across Hertz's and Leonard's writings, written before 1905, indeed even before 1900, and thus before Einstein. That Hertz work, edited by Leonard, stated that there was still an older concept of energy, and that older concept recognized a potential energy or an additional hidden kinetic energy as possibly also contributing to a system's total energy. And then specifically that the vis viva energy of a system, the lebendige Kraft, to use the German expression, is twice the kinetic energy, repeat, is equal to twice the visible kinetic energy. And after I learned of that very old concept, I reconsidered system energies, including those in my slide. And I realized that Einstein's 1 mv squared, or even 1 mc squared, instead of 1/2 mc squared, was also not especially new after all. But unlike some of Einstein's critics, such as Edmund Whittaker, this is not intended to minimize Einstein's contribution. Einstein behaved quite appropriately and progressively by submitting his very simple, clear, and sufficiently accurate conclusion to a journal, his conclusion, and that was published in September 1905. And in effect, Einstein's conclusions, combining some worthy prior existing physics concepts and applying those to light, and regardless of any merit of his derivational methods, which was also published there. So this talk is not meant, so to speak, to take much away from what Einstein did, but instead to see that other scientists before him do not get inappropriately marginalized or left out. And I agree with Einstein that it is likely that a star's kinetic energy and a star's high temperature do in effect add to its mass and inertia. But I think the situation is more complicated than Einstein's 1905 second relativity paper indicates. Here's one example. Consider the case of a body that is somewhat like a neutron star or black hole, or just an ultra-strong gravitational body. The lighter emissions will have lost substantial amounts of energy before it virtually escapes the star's gravity. And thus, if the final escaped energy is measured after it virtually is free or almost free of the emitting body's influence, consider this. When the energy amount is measured, what is received in flight, the effective visible or measured energy of the star may be substantially less than its initial contribution to a body's inertia mass times c squared. Thus, a body's effective measurable or free net energy thus does not equal mc squared. So it is generally less than that, as Hertz warned, due to the invisible gravity, often thought of as hidden potential energy. But I still think of stars' internal high temperature and plasma in motion does in effect increase the body's mass m, more than just if it were cool. Even if due to high gravity, an ultra-high mass star may have almost no net energy, repeat, almost no net energy relative to outer space. In other words, that there is a relativeness even to energy, and that two small equal masses orbiting close together and clockwise has the same average mass as they would if they were orbiting in opposite directions, even though the opposite direction case has greater kinetic collision energy. Time does not permit me to more holistically discuss all the implications and aspects of all the above. And time limitations also prevent me from discussing what would constitute a truly meritorious award and recognition system, not like our present patent and copyright system, which was criticized rightly by Buckminster Fuller and others. And that applies somewhat to even some huge foundation award systems. I comment more on that in the proceedings. So back to my slides and a few more comments about them. The slides aren't perfect because they are, so to speak, pictures of pictures, somewhat improvised. But in the upper left-hand side of the slide, we see a nearly ideal low-mass spring with force proportional to its stretched length. The high mass on the end of the spring is flying around in a circle at such high speed that its centripetal force, so to speak, balances steadily and well against the pull of the spring. Under those circumstances, the spring's potential energy equals the mass's flying kinetic energy, and the system's total energy is 1 mv squared, not 1/2 mv squared. At the lower left, is a similar spring, and a mass on it exhibits so-called simple harmonic motion, and exhibits a travel schedule in tune with the horizontal projection of the motion of system A above it. Let me just get my place here. So, although the oscillation goes between all kinetic energy with no potential energy and vice versa, we still note the following. The mean kinetic energy is equal to the mean potential energy at system B's P position below that 45 degree angle there, as shown compared to the sketch above it. Somewhat similarly again, we have a total energy of a simple harmonic system B equal to twice its average kinetic energy. And that is when we also include, instead of ignore, the system's potential energy. In system C, in the slide's upper right hand of the system, or sketch, we show a spinning thin tube with a very weak wall, not strong at all. But that's okay here because I've chosen the wall's spinning speed here to just create the right amount of centripetal pressure to be balanced against the gas pressure against the exterior surface wall of that spinning thin tube. And the tube's interior volume is under nearly perfect vacuum, which we'll imagine is, at least temporarily, maintained because of the caps we've placed on both tube ends. If those ends were left open, the exterior gas would rush in, destroying the vacuum inside. Now, actually, we might try dimming the lights a little bit, but it isn't all that important. Under those circumstances, the exterior gas, or exterior ether pressure, times the hollow tube's interior equals the kinetic energy of the spinning weak wall tube. It's the wall. And we'll think of the external pressure times the internal volume of the tube as potential energy which could potentially be used if a piston were placed as a substitute in place of the caps near the end of the tube to do work like an old steam engine's cylinder. Perhaps, except for the caps issue, the total energy of the system is twice the kinetic energy. Now, the listener may rightly protest that when the caps were on, there was an exterior pressure times the area of the cap that we have inappropriately ignored. And that's why we've also substituted, we've also illustrated system D below the system C. There we have done away with the caps by letting the otherwise open tube ends butt against each other to maintain a tube's interior vacuum. That system is somewhat like a whirling vortex. And Helmholtz and his theorem remind us that such schemes as the termination of one tube end against another, against its other end, is necessary for more stability than would the instability that would otherwise be present. And Helmholtz also reminds us that there is another style or type of termination that is also more supportive of stability than otherwise. Like, consider that in the spinning tube or whirling water vortex was in a swimming pool, and the vortex curved around only 180 degrees instead of 360 degrees. Then the ends would be made to sort of terminate at the water-to-air surface of the swimming pool, and with the rest of the whirling vortex remaining underwater. And that seems to indeed improve stabilization relative to just having one loose end dangling underwater. as one or more videos viewable online seem to also demonstrate. Einstein's paper clearly proposed that even regardless of how much E worth of energy was withdrawn from a body, a mass, a decrease of E over C squared would result, that is the mass equal to E divided by C squared lessening would result. And that clearly stated was a step forward. And he may have inferred that even a very cold body mass might have a energy associated with it equal to the mass time of the body times C squared. And perhaps that was a new inference or speculation. But even in old ether theory, a slug of pure mass would displace a highly pressurized ether from the volume of space occupied by the pure slug of matter, and thus in proportion to the amount of mass, and thus there would exist, in a sense, a potential energy equal to the slug's mass times the ether pressure. That ends this presentation. Thank you. And questions or comments are welcome if time allows.
Questions for Carl?
Okay.
I do have a question. Was the underwater experiments, you were in the Yonel, the new experiments?
I'm sorry, would you repeat
the that? Underwater experiments, were you talking about the Yonel Danu's experiments of the magnets, or what looks like to be magnetism?
Not in this case, but the thing that you were referring to is a magnificent thing. It's unforgettable, and it left me, who have played with many bar magnets in many ways, just convinced that that vortex, video is greatly establishes the merit of magnetism and magnets being so well an analogy with such water tube behaviors, using the spinning propeller and so on. The one that I was referring to is, I wish I had more details, but it is just one online, and I do one's welcome to send me. I'll tell you, sometime I'll just send you a reference to it.
Okay, that sounds good. Okay, that's great. Thank you. Any other questions? Okay, go ahead.
My name is Francis. What is VT? And whenever we talk about velocity, it is an attribute of some mass, because something has to move. So how would you define VT?
Well, there may be a lack of clarity in my drawing. You say VT, the product of velocity times time?
Suffix, tangential velocity.
Oh, that's what I meant, thank you. VT is the tangential velocity. Maybe it should have been referred to simply as speed instead of velocity, but at this 45 degree angle here that I took, it may as well be shown, I guess, as V. So now I understand the terminology of your question, but I've forgotten the question. Certainly, if the spring broke, that heavy mass there, that very massive thing would break off and proceed into outer space at that velocity, v, that tangential velocity, and if that tangential velocity was the velocity of light, it would, if the spring broke up, proceed. And if it dragged the spring with it, then the mass would have a kinetic energy of 1/2 mv squared, and the spring, which would be vibrating back and forth, would and wiggle that mass a little bit as it flew at the speed of light, would have another 1/2 mv squared, 1/2 mc squared of energy. So the total system, as it wiggled its way, would be 1 mv squared. But I don't advocate that particular thing as a real good model for the speed for light. Thank you.
Wait, Carl,
okay.
Can you answer any more questions? Okay, can you get the microphone, please?
Yes.
If you have a question, please get yourself ready for the microphone.
Okay. In a moving electric charge.
Microphone's not on?
No.
You gotta press the button now.
You gotta push it
up. In a moving electric charge, where is the energy, where is the kinetic energy contained? Is it in the magnetic field, in the electric field, or where is the kinetic energy contained?
I strongly feel that the, and I'm thinking about some of these answers I give are off the cuff, and they might not be accurate, but I have always felt that at least in some types of light, a considerable amount of that energy is in the field, which is in the ether, and that there is a ether compression, perhaps compression and then relaxation and then compression again, and that it is giving the so-called photon, assuming that the photon is flying through space, which a lot of people don't believe, but so I think that the energy comes from both the electromagnetic energy comes from the ether around it, and furthermore that vibration is clearing the way so the mass can proceed indefinitely without much weakening in its energy. I mean, without the drag. I realize that's not a total great answer, but that's my response anyway.
Do you have Dad, if it's not a question, we have questions still. Yes.
Okay, we have a question from Slobodan Nedic on the internet. He says, could one go with just 2 times a kinetic energy of the related ether flows instead of having potential equals 1/2 mv squared? He goes on to say, I meant kinetic energies of ring and toroidal flows in a toroidal vortex, both with v equals c.
Well, I think you'd have to repeat that question, but even if you repeated it, I'm not sure that I could answer it. Could you repeat that one more time?
Could one go with just 2 times a kinetic energy of the related ether flows instead of having potential equals 1/2 mv squared?
I'm a little bit confused about what he's talking about.
I think that's a possibility. The problem to me is that light is still somewhat of a mystery. that is, I don't understand everything about it. I don't understand everything about gravity too, either. And I think sometimes our experiments, we rush into experiments and conclusions, and we conclude too much based upon a phenomenon, either light or gravity, that we have not absolutely, completely and clearly satisfactorily explained. In fact, you or someone else may have it right, but I'm a little open-minded as to what will be the final answers. Does that kind of...
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Carl has handed out these DVDs. If you don't have one, I have more. Also, he has a paper. Carl, what do you want to do with the paper? That was in the bag here. I didn't know what to do with those.